I'm losing my dictions.
Get your dictions back in your mouth. Butterscotch
Shenanigans. Hey everybody, welcome to episode 36 of Coffee with Butterscotch, the game dev comedy podcast of Butterscotch Shenanigans. I'm Seth, and I'm the games programmer.
I'm Adam, and I'm the Webbles programmer.
And I'm Sam, and I make art.
And today is January 26th?
I don't know what year it is anymore.
2016?
What year is it?
Before we get started, we have a warning. Anything can happen on this show. There might be profanity,
lewdness,
innuendos.
There's going to be shitloads of profanity this time.
So if you got a beef or a ham with that, then get away right now.
Yeah, but if you got a turkey with it, I'm pretty sure you should continue listening.
Turkey is delicious.
If you got a turkey, you're going to want to baste it and then brine it for at least 24 hours before you deep fry it.
Well, yeah, but so then you're going to want to put a chicken inside of it.
And then you're going to want to put a ring on it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Definitely.
As the saying goes.
Mm-hmm.
So what happened this week, you guys?
So this is the post-launch podcast, really, I guess, right?
Yeah.
That's right.
We still got a few days left on various feature spots and stuff, but we launched Crashlands on Thursday of last week.
And
it's been crazy. We're all very tired.
Yeah, and before we get into the, you know... Before we get into the bowl of grits about what happened with the Crashlands launch, I think it would be very important for us to take a moment to just say thank you to everybody who was involved in making this game happen.
Yeah.
In particular, our spouses who supported us for 2 friggin' years while
Without
we made this
them,
thing.
There would be no Crashlands.
You know, they believed in us, and even though they saw the backs of our heads more often than the fronts, also known as faces.
It depends on which side of your head your face is.
You have a beautiful front of head.
They still stuck with us through it, and we just have to thank them for that.
And they brought home the bacon the whole time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also our 180 testers, which did a phenomenal job. They found 25 single spaced pages worth of bugs. So even though there are some bugs in the game post-launch, just imagine had we not tested it. The people at Apple and Google and Valve who, you know, saw fit to pick out Crashlands for those feature spots on the stores, that's really what launch day comes down to. Mm-hmm. And if it weren't for those, then...
It would have been a flop.
My God, nothing would have happened.
Yeah.
And, of course, last but not least, everybody who's playing the game, you know, thank you guys so much for, you know, taking the chance to throw down some cash on our first, what we would consider our first legit pay up front game. I know we kind of are bucking the trend in the mobile market by not making a free game that slaps you in the face with ads all the time and steals money from your wallet while you're sleeping, but...
That's our next game. Money Stealer.
That's our next game, but... But yeah, just, you know, thank you all for ponying up the fiver.
Yeah, and I do want to say also on top of that, you guys have been great for also directing some increased review coverage and stuff. We asked people to tweet at Total Biscuit, for example, and IGN to get them basically to pay attention to Crashlands and to cover it. And it's been really surreal because Total Biscuit, which for those of you who don't know, who does a series called What the Fuck Is, and then he does basically like a 40-minute sort of... It's like a combination design, deep dive, and critique of a game. We really want to get one of those for Crashlands, and so he basically tweeted out that he had been playing it. And we were like, what? And
which then the first step.
Yeah, and then the president of Gearbox.
Of the United States? Oh, no. Okay,
no, sorry. Just Gearbox. Close enough for us. Tweeted about it as well, so that was really cool. And Rami, who's the guy who runs Vlambeer, which makes Nuclear Throne and Ridiculous Fishing. So we've had a good sort of splash on that. And I also wanted to say thanks to all of our reviewers, the Twitch streamers, the YouTubers, the guys at Twitch Arcade for writing the glowing article there, and also for their forums just existing. So we've had some fun contact with a lot of iOS players through their forums. So
and
thanks to everybody
and our moderators who are currently of our forums and our subreddit who are currently just being just buried in. I mean, this is something that we didn't really anticipate because our previous games have all been small enough that people didn't really feel the need to like jump into forums and subreddits and ask questions. They just kind of played them. Crashlands is so huge, and there's so many little kind of nooks and crannies that people can get lost in that people are taking to the forums and to the subreddit and you know, sharing pictures of their bases and asking questions about quests and just sharing suggestions and ideas on cool stuff that they want to see in the game. And it's awesome, but we were completely unprepared for it.
Yeah, well, it also, it goes against the, especially in the forums. The point of the forums is a place for people who are into Butterscotch games to come together and just talk about life and stuff. And now it's turned into basically a support system, which is much less good of a thing for it to be.
We get this first bug fix patch out, that'll fall away a little bit. But yeah, we have like Twitter, we have the Steam discussion forums, we have the game forums, we have the subreddit, and we have a Discord chat server. So we have five different places where people are going to, you know, throw bug reports and just like how pumped they are about stuff, you know, anything. And so we're trying to come up with a better system to sort of funnel people into the right channels for their
the main problem we're facing is that when somebody wants help, they don't look for an answer or the right channel. They just pick the first channel they see, go into it, and start asking for help. So that's really that's the situation we're in, trying to figure out how to get around.
And seriously, last one for real, Yo-Yo Games. Thank you to Yo-Yo Games, the creators of Game Maker. That's the engine that we used to make Crashlands. Mm-hmm. They make an incredible product if you're interested in getting into 2D game development. It's just Game Maker is just the way to go. And they've also been really, really helpful on the launch. There were a couple sort of bumps when we launched the game on Steam.
Yeah.
And they've been very responsive in helping us figure out what the fixes would be for that and getting that taken care of. So those guys are awesome. Okay. Fact. So let's actually get talking about the launch. What happened?
I don't remember.
We did it in a time warp. It's like a bullet time.
Well, so we hit the button for both Android and iOS on Wednesday night, right? So the stores, both those stores, they turn over around 2 p.m. On Thursday afternoons. And so you have to have your game out for a while beforehand to make sure it's fully propagated before you get a feature spot. So we always do that around 11 p.m., which we did, I think, at 10, just to, because we were very excited. And we hit that and then basically watched things to make sure nothing was broken. So we went to bed, slept for, I believe, each of us about 3 or 4 hours, got back up at 6 and then launched on Steam at 7 o'clock.
In the
morning. And from then on, it was just sort of, it was this waiting game to see what reviews would come in, what the stores would actually do, because you're not guaranteed any of the stuff. So no one lets you know, like, hey, we're going to feature your stuff. They tend to be like, you're being considered for a feature, is essentially how they phrase it. So we were very antsy because it could be great, it could be terrible. But we had just had this big list of this sort of wish list of all the stuff that we had put all the gears in motion to allow it to happen if other people would sort of play ball with us. And
well, I also want to say too that doing this triple simultaneous launch was a risky move.
Mm-hmm.
In a lot of ways, we've talked to various publishers and stuff before we, you know, just decided to say no, we'll just do it ourselves. And every single one of them told us that launching on three platforms at once was just an awful idea. So,
what was their reasoning, though, Seth? It's good.
The reasoning was basically, well, there are a couple reasons. One is if you launch on PC first, then people will perceive the game as having a higher value. They'll perceive it as being a PC game. And then when you move it over, when you release it on mobile later, then the game is viewed as like having that like higher integrity of a PC game.
Mm-hmm.
Another was like to extend the life cycle of the game. So, you know, games do have a fairly short life cycle. You know, you'll still get sort of a trickle of income from them after a couple of years even. But compared to that, you know, that launch period, it's just, you know, it's nothing.
It's not really comparable, in fact.
Yeah. And so the idea is basically by continually releasing new versions of the game, say every like 6 months, like start on PC, then, you know, go to Android, then go to iOS or something, or the other way around for most people. Then I guess each time you do that, you get another sort of like spike in interest and in news talking about the game and that kind of thing. So we didn't listen to those. What do you guys want to talk about? Why we?
Well, I mean, part of the big reason is that we were trying to angle our studio into being basically the cross-platform studio, where the games we make don't just belong to PC or to mobile. They are just games that you happen to be able to play on PC and mobile, and that's going to be, no matter how we do it, that's just going to be a really weird thing, because there's no studio right now that's actually trying to angle itself into that particular position because of the risk involved, I think. And this is something that we were really worried about going into launch, which is that, because we've tried to put ourselves sort of between the two, is it going to be the case
orphaned.
Like having to deal with like mixed heritage. It's the same sort of thing where it's like, who do I belong to?
There was an additional argument, which we heard a lot, which is, so it is a fact that you can't charge the same amount for a game on mobile and PC. I mean, people have tried it, resulting in spectacular failure, because it's not possible. Those markets are just different. They're totally different from each other. So prices are suppressed in mobile, so you have to charge less if you want to sell anything. It's just how it is. And so one of the sort of common wisdom items is that if you launch a game on both platforms at once, because you sell it for cheaper on mobile, then people will buy it instead only on mobile, even if they would have bought it on PC for the higher rate, and therefore you're sort of cannibalizing your own potential income.
Which might be true, but
I think it's not.
Well, I think it's also not true necessarily in our case because of the cross-platform nature of the game, which is that you can play it the same game that your save has been on both. And so we had a few people, you know, tweet us pictures of their setups where they tweet us a picture of their PC next to an Android tablet and then their phone, their iPhone off in the distance, and all three have CrashLands on them. Right? So it's like, right. Because they're like, I want to be able to do it everywhere. That's exactly
the point. And I mean, and our rationale was that, what we've basically set up is a way that people can, if they can afford it and want to, they can play CrashLands no matter where they are on any interface they prefer when they're at that place, right? So if they're at home and have a laptop or a PC with a nice big screen that they prefer to play games on, they can play CrashLands on it. If they also want to be able to take it to work, they can do that.
Yeah, but also think about the idea that if $15 is outside of their price range for the Steam version,
yeah, then they still get to buy it.
Yeah, they still have a way to get their hands on the game. Yeah. So
instead of having to wait until they save up enough to buy it on Steam, they can actually just keep on playing the game. And then eventually, if they think they can afford it on Steam and still would prefer to play it there, then they can do that too down the road. Yeah, right. I mean, so I think if you're selling a game that has sort of a short memory footprint for the person playing it, meaning they could play it for a few hours and be like, oh, that's enough of that, then yeah, it's absolutely true that you're going to cannibalize your sales, because somebody will buy it in one place, mm-hmm. play it until they get tired of it, and then why would they buy it somewhere else? But we never believed CrashLands was that kind of game. We always thought it was something that somebody would play and then just play the crap out of.
But I think the best argument, or sort of the best, how do I put it? The best argument that we got against, or the most hilarious argument we got against doing this was basically, in a nutshell, nobody does this because it doesn't work.
Yeah.
But our intuition sort of fired up, and especially Adam as the scientist was like, if nobody does this, how do we know that it doesn't work? Mm-hmm. Right. You know, it's that, is it tautology?
Yeah. It's
some kind of circular reasoning.
Is the right word. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, a real life analog would be, you know, nobody finds me attractive, so I don't bother taking showers. You know,
yeah,
it's a statement whose inverse is its own explanation. So yeah, it doesn't work to launch on multiple platforms because nobody's doing it. Well, nobody's doing it because it doesn't work. Well, who knows?
Yeah, who knows? Yeah.
So, but I think it worked out.
For us, the sort of the major rationale otherwise was we just figured, If somebody sees CrashLands and knows that people can play it, then they ought to be able to play it. And if they can't, then that's actually a problem, because that means either they have to wait for it, And maybe they'll forget about it by that time. Maybe the hype will die down. I mean,
right.
You know,
who
knows what'll happen.
After going through through this lunch, I mean, lunches are extremely taxing on
us.
Yeah,
why do it a bunch of times?
let's sign up to repeat last week two more times in the next 2 months. Like, no.
Yeah, I mean, it's exciting, but...
But good
yeah.
God, like, I need a nap, I need a massage, I need to play some games, you know? Yeah. Like, we're all just wiped over here.
And we haven't gotten to do any of that stuff yet, because we're still working on the emergency bug patch.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I can tell you right now, my dream scenario is just laying in my bed, staring at the ceiling for 12 hours. That's what I want to be doing right now. Oh,
yeah. Every time we've gone out to eat for the past couple of days, all of us just sit there and silently chew our food and stare blankly out
like
the window.
It's the one moment where we don't have to be thinking, so right. We just stop doing it.
And I mean, poor Diana, my fiance, was asking me questions about some other stuff we got going on with like friends coming over or dinner stuff. And I was like, I can't answer any questions. And she was like, what?
You're just going to be a passenger in life for
and
the
I was
next
like,
week.
Yeah, I was like, yeah, I was like, just write them down. I'll get to them later.
I'll pencil you in, fiance.
So it's weird. Yeah. But as far as you know, the question of expectations, what were our expectations and did they get met? They did get met. But we don't really have very high expectations, so it's not too hard to do.
I'll put it this way though. I think we have high goals, but our expectation was that nothing would happen.
Yes.
Because for almost every game that hits the market, that's exactly what happens, right?
Yeah.
So, but on the flip side, I think this launch feels, it feels less exciting than previous launches because we planned it for so long. Things are happening exactly as we tried to get them to happen. It wasn't a surprise what happened.
Yeah, we were glad that all the things happened as we wanted.
Yeah, and I think a good way to think about it is, it wouldn't have been surprising if nothing happened at all, but it also wouldn't really have been surprising if something did happen. Because either one was equally likely, really.
I wouldn't say that even a little bit. What are you talking about? With all the pre-launch hype we had, and it was primarily, you know, focused around people who knew about our previous games, and the audience isn't that huge and so on. It would have been super surprising if nothing happened.
Yeah, that would be weird.
I mean, there were a lot of ways
it
could have
well.
Like gone pretty poorly.
I guess the way I would think about it is you think about like training for the Olympics or something. So say you got like the best coach and you're training for like 2 years and you know what it takes. You know, sort of like you have a vague idea of what the recipe is to actually do this.
Yeah, so you do everything right.
Yeah, so that's what we tried. That was our goal. So, okay, we hit all these things that we know exist that previously, for all of our previous launches, we had no idea that they were rules or that this was a thing we could do, whatever else. And we just listed all of them out and then just tackled each one of them one by one, including designing a game that was, you know, is designed specifically to be able to both reach across platforms as well as to just be like a lovable, playable experience for anyone. And
yes,
I think
but just
so,
like in the Olympics, once you actually get to you, then you have exactly one moment to go take those years of work and prove to the world that you're the best. And if you've got a cold that day, if you misstep off of the block, mm-hmm. if you dive a little funny and your goggles fly off, you know, like there's a thousand little random things that can happen that can then range in their effects from a complete disaster to a slight slowdown to actually being a surprising benefit. Like maybe you lose your swimming trunks and now your nudeness lets you swim faster.
Boom. Mm-hmm.
You know? Smooth
or you have a lot of extra drag because of your ghiblies.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Depends
but
on
yeah,
who you
but,
are.
But I think it is important to remember that, you know, for every person who, you know, who you see at the Olympics, there were 1,000 people
who didn't
did have
there.
Those experiences on the way, you know, and didn't get to the end.
Right.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there are a lot of things that could have gone wrong. I think it went about as well as we could have hoped. So sort of end results were we got editor's choice in the United States for iPad,
mm-hmm.
which is cool. We've never gotten that that honor before. We were also featured on iPhone. We did not get editor's choice, but we were featured there.
Well, I want to say something funny about this because the documentary crew is here filming on launch night/day. And so if you watch the film, I'm sure they're going to cut it in there, which is that we were waiting for the iStore to turn over, the App Store, and we were actually super disappointed when we reloaded it and the page turned up and we didn't see Crashlands there and the banners until we rotated like four banners to the left and there it was. And we were like, oh, okay, well, you know, we got a feature, so that's fine. But it was like the first one.
Number two in the top new games.
Yeah, so we're like, okay, you know, it's okay. It's good, I guess. Not what we were hoping
it's
for.
Actually
but
great,
it's great. It is still great.
It's
but
good. We've been burned before by feature spots where we got a feature on the front page, but because we were in a position where the user had to scroll in one direction or something to get to the game,
the effect was like just 10x less powerful than it was.
So that's what we were like, oh man. So that's the part that was actually captured on film. But was more hilarious is that then about 2 hours later, we get a text from Graphite Labs, one of our dev studio buddies here in St. Louis, and the head of the studio is like, "Dude, you guys are featured on the iPad," and we're like, "What?" And he's like, "Yeah, your editor's choice first banner on the iPad." He's like, "That's the best spot to get," and we didn't know that there's actually, because none of us use iDevices, so we didn't know there was two stores.
We didn't know there's a different store.
There's two stores, and we're like, "Oh shit!"
Well, all we've been able to afford in terms of, you know, devices for testing has been these like old iPod Touch fifth generation devices. Yeah. So that was our point of reference for what was on the App Store. So
pretty funny.
Whoops. We also got a. Like, we got a pretty decent feature spot on Google Play. It's in the new and updated category.
It's decent in that we are in the list of featured games.
Yeah, but you do need to scroll. I think we are listed at the number 5 or 6 spots. So you have to scroll
over.
You got
to scroll to get there. So most people will.
So, but still, despite that, I think maybe just because of all the hype that we've been building and all the buzz and the fact that it's on the iPad and it's, you know, everywhere else, we were getting a lot of search traffic for it, which pushed the game up to the number one top new paid apps spot.
Which is amazing.
And it's also at the number 3 spot just for top paid apps in general, which is behind Minecraft and a racing game.
Yeah.
So that's cool.
Both of which I think actually have in-app purchases, so there's no way we're going to step in front of them.
I don't think Minecraft does.
It does.
Oh, well,
Minecraft is in-app purchases.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what they are, but they have some. It says on it has in-app purchases, so they're able to make more money off of any given player than we are. So
and speaking of Minecraft, Minecraft is also in our way on the iTunes App Store. It is we're the number 2 spot now for top paid apps, and Minecraft is number 1. So, we're working on it. I think they have something on the order of like 50 million sales.
Hey man,
on the order of infinite money.
Not dollars, actual sales. Right. So, probably not likely.
No. Yeah. One of the other fun things we've been looking at are we had a bunch of reviews come in from all over on mobile, as well as actually a bunch on PC, which we're very excited about. Since we haven't gotten anything on PC ever before. So that was nice. We got PC Gamer and a couple other bigger sites like Kotaku. And our Metacritic score actually on mobile is currently sitting at 99.
Yeah. It was 100.
It was 100.
Pocket Gamer.
Pocket Gamer came along. And they were like, this game's great. 9 out of 10. So
yeah.
So they messed up our perfect score, but that's okay. You know, that's okay.
We kind of knew that was going to happen, though.
We did.
Wait, yeah. We were like,
we were betting on it.
Yeah, we were betting that Pocket Gamer would be the one. That would knock it. I don't know why, just something about it.
just felt like it was going to happen.
And also, somebody has pirated a copy of the game and uploaded it onto Amazon for $5. So
nice. Go ahead and, you know, go get it over
you
there.
If you bought that, you might want to ask for a refund because
it will soon be taken away from you anyway.
Yeah.
And you don't want to boot it up because who knows what the fuck has been done to it.
And also, as we update the game on other platforms, that version will become out of date and it will break.
Yeah,
it won't let you play anymore. So that'll be bad. And yeah, otherwise, I think the last kind of thing to hit on that's been really interesting. Well, there's a couple things, but one of them has been every now and then we'll get a sort of a comment on a, you know, like a Reddit thread or something where somebody will say one of two things. One is, this trailer is not funny. I did not even crack a smile. That's one thing they'll say. The other thing they'll say is, this game looks like it's made for children, not interested. So, what do you guys think about that?
I think, you know,
fuck them.
If you got, if you have such a black hole of joy in your heart that you can't crack a smile at something that doofy.
Yeah, we don't want you playing our games.
Go away.
Yeah.
Go back to the hellhole you crawled out of.
It's a trap that a lot of game developers may fall into. Because like if you make something, like if you pour your heart and soul into something and you put it up on the internet and some people like it, there's still going to be a large group of people who just hate it.
Even
right?
if it's a small fraction.
It's yeah, even if it's number. 1%, you know, it doesn't matter. And it's really hard not to, you know, take that to heart, I guess. Where like
no,
you
I don't
made
have
a thing
with it anymore? Fuck them.
Not anymore. I think we're kind of accustomed to it. But I think when you're first getting started, it can be really like upsetting. Oh, yeah. Because you really tried hard. You made a thing that you're proud of, and somebody comes in and they're just like, poof, you know,
fuck this thing you made.
Yeah, and actually, I think it was Eli Hodep from Touch Arcade had this hilarious tweet where he said, I have a new hobby, which is going to Reddit and seeing how far and where somebody has made a cool thing that they're really proud of and seeing how far down I have to scroll before somebody just like shits on it. And the first reply to that was, oh, so you just read the top comment, which is true. Like there was a post of somebody like, hey, check out this carrot cake I made. And it was just amazing. Like it just looked incredible. And the top comment was, that's probably one of those cakes that looks cool but tastes like shit.
Like, yeah, like what the fuck?
And then there was like 900 replies to that of people being like, yeah, fuck this cake, you know.
what are you guys doing? Go away.
Good.
Yeah, but I think, you know, it's you if you make something, you have to just be aware that the thing you made isn't for everyone.
Yeah.
And the people who it is for, those are the ones that you should care about.
Yeah, those are your people.
So when somebody comes in and says, this game is for children, you know, I'm not going to play it. It's like, good. Just go away. We don't want you touching anything we make.
I guess
you're just going to be mad the whole time.
Yeah. I think about it kind of like, so I talked to some of my friends about this because some of my friends who are more sort of private or don't necessarily share stories just, you know, out of the blue. I had this interesting discussion with them where I was like, you know, why is it the case that you don't necessarily just give people stories about, you know, where you've been, what your life's been like, that sort of thing. And, the interesting response was something along the lines of not wanting to basically be judged, right? So trying to kind of keep a privatized or sort of quiet sphere so as to not cause any problems and also, not risk anything, which I think is really interesting because I use storytelling in conversation, the same sort of idea of this, where we put a bunch of, character and a bunch of ourselves into the trailer, for example, of this game. As well,
literally,
as
it's your voice.
Yeah,
literally.
Well, yeah, and it's our humor. It's the kind of stuff that we find entertaining. You know?
Right. And so, yes, that means it's guaranteed to be very off-putting to some people because it has a very strong sense to it. But, that's totally fine because the purpose of it, as well as like storytelling in a social context, in my mind has always been actually as like a feed forward mechanism for selecting people. So for example,
it's a filter.
It's a filter. So it's actually designed to filter people out.
Yeah. So if I sit down with someone new and I freely within like 3 minutes of talking to them, you know, let them know about the cancer stuff and they have like a poor reaction to that, you know, then that's great because I don't have to waste any more time with that.
Yeah, you don't have to talk to that person.
I can move on. And so,
if somebody says something racist or homophobic,
right,
or whatever, then you're like, okay, I don't need to talk to this person anymore, right? It just sort of it allows you to spend your time focusing on the people who aren't jackasses,
right? And the only way, like, to not offend people is just to sort of, you know, quiet that self. But then you're letting everybody else be in control, which is dumb. You know?
Yeah, it's better to get those short moments of being uncomfortable followed by long periods of actually being surrounded by people who care about you and want to be around you instead of people who have no idea who you are but are just around all the time.
Well, I think a lot of it, too, is that people feel like they need to convince people that their shitty ideas are shitty and stuff. And I mean, I definitely used to be. I was in that camp for 25 damn years. And then at some point, all of a sudden, I was like, why am I wasting my time on this, you know? Yep. There's just no reason for it. You might as well just go enjoy the limited time you have with the subset of people who are just the people that you want to be around.
Because, surprise, you're going to die someday. And if you spend any of that time complaining about someone else's accomplishments on the internet, you've wasted your life.
You just lost. Yeah, so in a nutshell, we're going to keep making games that are whimsical and packed full of jokes and look like they're made for children because we want our players to be people who have a sense of whimsy. Joy and happiness and whimsy about
or who need that in their lives.
I think one of our
to go get it.
One of our reviewers put it best where he said, "You will love this game unless you're a fun-hating ogre."
Yeah. Like, in which case, that's fine. You know, it's not for you. So
go back to your cave.
Nothing is for you. Just go just go away.
Just go fuck yourself.
And then we've also had a really sort of interesting, I just want to hit on this kind of quickly. We've had an interesting back and forth about being judged by the PC crowd, the PC press.
As in, personal computer, not
political correctness. Yeah.
Although we've had some of that too.
The biggest one I think is sort of culminated in the PC Gamer review, which is sort of, you know, it's kind of what you'd expect. It's sort of the most hardcore of like PC is everything kind of publication, right? So they're going to view everything through the lens of PC versus everything else. But it's really interesting. I definitely recommend reading that review because it's very evident that the reviewer decided that this was a mobile game, period, and then viewed all the mechanics from that context, even in ways that made no sense.
To their detriment, oftentimes.
Yeah, and so one of the more bizarre ones was when the reviewer said, you know, this game isn't really fun on PC because it was clearly designed for mobile pacing because you know, it's an RPG and I'm replacing my gear about every hour. And that's clearly more engineered toward mobile gamers.
Which we had a good hearty laugh about.
Yeah, so we come from the mobile games industry, and we know that the average mobile gameplay session is 2.5 minutes, and the average mobile gamer plays for 2 sessions a day, which means 5 minutes a day, which means it would take you 12 days of playing to get a gear upgrade on mobile. Like if it were a mobile game, right? And then if you play a game like Diablo or something, which is a PC game, you're getting gear upgrades way faster than that. So it was just kind of, it was interesting to see how thinking about the game as a mobile game automatically just created nonsensical arguments.
Well, the other big part of this was this whole controller or WASD keyboard movement request.
Yes.
Where again, because everybody just says, oh, this is a mobile game ported to PC, that's why you have to click to do things. Where in fact, you click to do things because that's the best control scheme for this game. And the game was designed around that control scheme. So they go hand in hand. And yeah, I mean, we could design other mechanisms like a controller or keyboard or whatever. And yeah, we would do the best we can to make them work really well, but they inevitably won't work as well because the game's not designed that way. But
it's just going to be a worse experience.
Yeah, but people took it in the lens of, well, because this is available on mobile, they're just being lazy and not putting in these alternate control schemes because this is just, you know, a port of a mobile game. Instead of, because I think Seth, when we were talking about this, he made the point that, you know, if someone's playing, say, Diablo or something, which is also just a click, all click to control, you don't say, oh, this is just point and click because you don't interpret that in some other weird way. You just say like, oh, this is how the game is played.
Yeah. Right? I mean, where are all the people commenting on, you know, jumping into the Diablo subreddit, basically being like, game looks cool, I guess, but
clearly designed for mobile.
Not playing it until controller support is added. Yeah. You don't really see that. And so, yeah, it's been interesting. And I think it's just sort of a symptom of this is our first PC game. It's our first, you know, like bursting onto the PC scene, and it's going to take some time to sort of build up that trust with the Steam players that we aren't just like making a mobile game and then slapping it onto Steam. We're trying to actually make something that just works on everything.
Yeah, and that will make the game play as well as possible on anything we put it on.
Well, my favorite quote from the PC Gamer article, I think, really summarizes the whole thing. Is actually the one that he chose to like make really big in the big fancy text, which says, "Crashlands is a great game on mobile, and or but is only a good game on PC. Which is just, it's an interesting thing to say, because it's the same damn
game. It's literally the goddamn same.
It's exactly the same.
And so when you say something like that, I guess the question is kind of like, what's that, what does that actually say? Either about the reviewer's lens or about the markets in particular? Because it is true that our reviews, like we said, on mobile, on Metacritic, are something like 99, and on PC are 81. And so,
but it's the same game.
But it is the same game. And so there's obviously, I think part of it is that the mobile crowd is actually starved for basically premium game experiences that are like those on PC, which is probably part of the reason why we essentially had if you would call it an inflated score, because relative to a lot of the stuff there, it's a better game, right?
People were ready for something like this.
Right. But I think on PC, if you're looking at relative to, I think that's where I think his point makes sense, which is that relative to other stuff that you could get on PC, it makes sense that it only falls into sort of the good category.
Well, but it just depends on how you're rating. So, because if your rating is, and I think this comes down a lot to what your really hardcore, like the sort of stereotyped PC gamer cares about, which is graphics and controllers and things actually being the same as they are. Because that's a lot of the complaints we get are, oh, I play a lot of RPGs, and this doesn't use RPG mechanics in the exact same way as these other ones I play. Therefore, I'm upset about this, right? Mm-hmm. It's that they believe that games are supposed to be a certain way.
True. Or that there are certain features. And
there are certain features that are required to make it a PC game.
Yeah, which because of our inexperience in the PC area, we didn't anticipate some of those. Like, for example, there are some players who have three monitors lined up and hooked together using a surround system, which gives them a 5:1 aspect ratio.
Right.
The game actually automatically adjusts its aspect ratio to match that of your monitor, but we never thought about somebody having an aspect ratio larger than 1.77:1. Yeah. But so that was interesting. So I mean, there are some things we got to work.
Yeah, I think we've definitely learned a bunch of stuff for our next PC thing, which is basically doing a better job. I mean, in a sense, it's almost like a localizing, right? Which
it is localization. You have
to speak the language of the platform you're going to. And we messed it up a little bit on mobile this time around as well with like the settings page, for example. Like most mobile games don't have settings pages, and on iPad, for example, when you view on the iPad Pro, which has an extremely high resolution, you can play the game in what we call the turbo huge aspect ratio on there, which basically zooms the game out, and you can see a lot more stuff, and that keeps everything nice and crisp. But it doesn't automatically do that. The game doesn't automatically detect and do that. And as a result, because most mobile games don't go in and mess with the settings first, they just play, we're getting complaints from people with the high-resolution iPad that it looked a little choppy, which it did. But it's interesting because whenever we watched a streamer play the game, who's always playing on PC on Twitch, the first thing they would do is open the settings menu.
Yeah, it's the first thing I do anytime I get any game ever is open the settings.
So
yeah.
So you set
mobile reset games don't have settings menus,
right? Yeah. So there's like all these really interesting things, and I think next time we're gonna knock it out of the park as far as making sure that we basically quote unquote localize into the appropriate things on each platform. I think we definitely missed a few things on the PC side. The mobile users didn't care because it was basically extra. Right. It wasn't like missing stuff. It was just kind of extra. And I think as well as we were really looking to take the graphical stuff up a notch for the next one, as far as shaders and effects and a bunch of other cool stuff.
I will say though, I will absolutely not apologize for streamlining the user interface.
Yeah, that was the weirdest general complaint that we've gotten or that we get.
We got a few comments from hardcore PC gamers basically saying this game sucks because of the fact that like I don't need to switch tools manually, I don't control like when my weapon comes out,
It was because they interpreted it as a mobile mechanic. Like they thought we did that just so that mobile users could play it, and that's why it was done, and then therefore they said it was a bad thing.
Well, yeah, the idea there is that simplification of user interaction makes the game too easy. Yeah.
Which, for those of you who played it and have sent us pictures of your graveyards.
Yeah, if you play the game for more than a few hours, you'll know that it gets hard.
Yeah, and our take on it is basically, you know, the mechanism by which you actually do the thing that you want to do, that's not supposed to be the hard part. The hard part is supposed to be doing the thing, not not like wrestling with a stupid UI or something. Yeah. So we're, you know, I'm not gonna apologize for that.
Never.
Okay, let's get to some questions. Normally at this point we would talk about games that we've been playing and sort of do some design discussion on those, but frankly we've barely slept because we've been doing this.
We have not been playing games. Although we should note that what is that game called?
The Witness.
The Witness is coming out today, and one thing that I'm very curious about. So we mentioned already that it's awesome that we've seen as much success as we have, but it's just kind of shitty to know that is necessarily happening, you know, at the cost to some other game developer somewhere, because we got a feature spot, and so we bumped out some potential person from getting that spot, for example.
Yep.
And because there, as much as we hate it, because we definitely feel like we're kind of all in the same boat with other indie devs and stuff, but at the same time, we also are necessarily competing with each other. And it'll be interesting to see what The Witness does, because this is this big, huge indie game made by the guy who made Braid.
It's being referred to in some places as a AAA indie game.
Yeah, it's a big. He spent 8 years and millions of dollars building this thing, and there's just so much hype and anticipation around this thing, and it comes out today, I believe. So one thing that will be really interesting to see is how the release of that game impacts our success on Steam.
Yes. Who knows?
Who knows? Yeah. Well, it's something to remember, for up and coming game devs is that you are unfortunately in competition with other people, and when you launch and what else is launching around that time will dramatically impact your sort of the limit of your success.
If I were a $40 to $60 game, I would hate to be launching this week.
Yeah, this would be like if you're anything but that game, you would be best served probably just to hold off and launch later.
Yep.
Because you're gonna be fighting some steep competition.
Yeah. All right, first question comes from these questions come from podcast.bscotch.net. If you want to ask questions for future podcasts and vote on them, just go there. Just go there and just throw some letters in the box.
Yeah.
All right, so the first question comes from Bohampshus, which is a sweet name, I have to say. Question is, on average, how many beers does it take before Flop Rocket becomes completely unplayable?
I think probably zero for most people.
Yes. But yeah, for most people, it's basically completely unplayable by default.
Yeah, but if you aren't most people, I think it would only take one beer probably, because like once you pour that on the phone,
yeah,
I mean it's done, the right? So, broken.
Or if you're holding one,
gone you forever.
Have, you don't have both your hands, so that's gonna be
that's yeah. true.
So pretty much true. Zero to one, I think.
Although a lot of people only play. Well, still, only play Flop Rocket, even if they play it a lot. A lot of people will only play it by just tilting the rocket at a 45-ish degree angle at the very beginning, and then just adjusting the throttle.
Yeah, but, you know, do you want to run out of fuel? Because that's how you run out of fuel.
Well, that's also how you accelerate uncontrollably until you end up blowing up on something.
That is also true.
Yeah.
Okay, next question comes from Kevin888. This question is mostly for Seth, but it can apply to anyone, too. I'm Seth, by the way. How do you keep focus?
Hi, Seth.
How do you keep focus on what you do, especially when programming? How do you stay interested in the game you are making? Does it ever become a chore for you and not fun anymore? No, it doesn't. It doesn't become a chore. I think it's a matter of perspective. So, like, let's say you are like building a house, right? In order to do that, you need to individually, you know, measure every board
and every nail
and every cut and pound in every nail, or use a nail gun, I guess.
That'd be much cooler.
And test everything. And it's a very long process. And every single individual thing you do, you know, you could think of it as a chore, but it doesn't really matter because you're not just like nailing boards. You're building a house. So I think like just knowing that you're working towards something big, it just makes all the little pieces enjoyable.
Cool, but also, you know? kind of from the flip side, you never actually make a game. You just program until a game is done, you know?
Yeah, like, you don't just go, I'm going to make it. Well, I guess sometimes you go, I'm just going to make a game today.
Still, what you actually do is sit down and program nonstop until a game comes out. So the only way to do it and enjoy it is to actually like programming.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, enjoy the work.
Yeah, so it doesn't become a chore. I mean, certainly various periods of time when you're like faced with some nightmare bug or have to do the same thing a jillion times or whatever. Like, certain aspects of it can become a chore. But on the whole, you know, like for me, I love programming. Seth loves programming. Sam enjoys it when he does it, but also loves the art that he's doing.
Mm-hmm. Well, but here's an interesting question, though, because I tried to become a programmer for years. I have piles of books to learn how to program, and I never could do it because I just did not enjoy it at all. And it really wasn't until I got GameMaker and I knew that every line of code that I was writing was going toward producing a game. Like that line of code was going to become part of the game. Well, no,
it's not even because it's a game. It's because now because coding is solving problems, right?
Now the problems are interesting.
The problems are interesting because most problems are boring as fuck, especially with like just like your average programming education course. It's like, I mean, it'll even be, I mean, my own experience with learning programming in any kind of official capacity, they're like teaching you how to like analyze business, like just dry as fuck business problems and stuff. And like,
yeah, I remember my final,
nobody finds that interesting except
my
for
final exam for my comp sci course when I was over at USC was just to write a program where there's like a painting company and they have these 20 different colors of paint and each color has its own price.
Yeah.
And you have to be able to estimate or the cost of paint, the paint that would go in a room of any dimension.
Right. And that was like watching paint dry.
But here's the thing.
But some people love that kind of a problem.
No, I mean, here's the thing. It's probably an interesting problem, you know, but all of the problems throughout the whole semester were like this. And
they weren't
interesting
to you.
Because it was so boring, I actually didn't learn enough programming to even be able to solve that problem.
But I think the interesting thing here, and this, I had the same problem with school in general for a lot of these, the same thing, which is that if someone's like, hey, just go nail these boards for 6 hours. I need you to just give me this pile of boards full of nails.
Yeah, that's a chore.
Then you're like, what that's the fuck? Chore. What's the point of this? And that's actually what every single instance of programming was, and even doing art up until we started making games was.
And that's what most people's jobs are like.
Right, because you don't actually...
Even in games, actually.
Yeah, even in games.
Yeah, because you really need to like buy into the overall vision of the thing. This is why also when you talk about just like being happy in a job or in a company or whatever else, the more you can actually get on board with the general company sort of like vision or the vision for whatever the project is that you're nailing nails to a board for, the happier your work will be because you see the bigger picture. And the point becomes way more obvious and way more enjoyable, I think, at the end.
It gives you reasons to do things.
Yep.
Yep.
Which turns out to matter a lot. All right, next question comes from Fweebers. Fweebers says, do you plan on any other designs for t-shirts if the first run is popular enough? This question is probably a little bit older, but because we just did a run of t-shirts. What characters would you consider putting on my chesticles? Which I think he means chest? I think that's...
Either unless, that unless or he means something else.
Yeah, unless he has a fundamental misunderstanding of what a shirt is and where it goes.
Or just has weird biology.
Yeah.
Also possible. Yeah, I think we really want to do a run of... t-shirts probably sometime in the next month, which would be a combination of the usual Butterscotch Shenanigans tee that you guys have seen us wearing, and then some character design stuff from Crashlands in particular. So we'll be doing some of those. We're going to put together a little tool to sort of both gauge interest as well as get people's info who are interested in that, and hopefully actually be able to make that such that people can see, and we can adjust the cost of stuff based on based on quantity, since that's essentially how it works on our end as well. So the more shirts we get,
we have to buy stuff in bulk to be able to get good stuff. And so it has to be planned out ahead of time.
Mm-hmm. Which does bring me to the idea of Flux Dave's plushies, which I want to do. So we need to try to figure out how to make that happen.
I personally want a juice box.
I personally want a fat fish plushie.
I want a juice box backpack.
No, Seth, a fat fish backpack where its mouth opens up and you shove stuff into its gaping maw.
Yes, I want a fat fish backpack.
I'm only down for that if you, when you want to open it, you have to like punch it in the gut super hard and it vomits everything out.
Yeah, and I also want a Flux Babes ski mask.
A ski mask?
With no mouth hole. Yeah, man. That would be...
Interesting. So you mean your face is just Flux's face?
Yeah, except for, I guess, for the eye holes.
Yeah, but I think without the glowing eyes, I don't think it would work. I think you have to have glowing eyes.
Who knows?
Otherwise, like, you just look like you're wearing a weird, like,
it'd be like Iron Man mask.
Weird purple and
yeah.
Think about it. Supposed to be like a weird knockoff Iron Man or what?
Yeah, if Iron Man had no lights behind his eyes, he looked pretty funny because you could see his eyes, his little eyeballs darting around in there, you know, looking left and right.
Yeah. It does make me wonder why his eyes are glowing. Because
it's cool. It's the same reason that Flux's eyes are cool.
That's true. Okay, this is a fun example. If you look at League of Legends champions, I noticed this. I think like 80% of them have glowing eyeballs.
Is that
for
right?
No reason. Absolutely no reason. Because glowing eyes so are cool. Sweet. They look great.
Yes. All right, next question.
We can retcon it though if we have to, but for this discussion, it's just because it's cool.
Yep.
Yes. Next question comes from MC. What kind of music do you guys listen to when you're gaming? Not developing, by the way.
Gaming. I listen to whatever music the game has.
Yeah, it depends on what the game is. If I'm playing like Terraria or something, then I listen to a song on repeat for weeks at a time. So
fact.
Yeah, it's super annoying when
that's
you're
just what I
off.
It helps. It helps me focus, man. Just
I'm like, I've heard this before.
Seth can just dimly hear a song in the background for weeks.
The worst, though, is Sam also likes to whistle along to the songs that he's listening to.
No, I don't like to. I do it mindlessly.
Or, yeah, he does it. It's just a habit.
What's the difference?
But but he'll only whistle the refrains. And so when Sam's listening to the same song for 3 weeks, about every 30 seconds, I just hear the same tune whistled.
Like four notes
for,
or so.
For weeks and weeks.
It's
a special kind of hell.
It's part of my strategy to drive Seth insane. Slow.
Yeah.
It's working.
I don't know. I usually try to listen to the music in games because I think it's important. I think it's an important part of games.
Yeah, especially
since it's typically designed for the game, you know?
Yep.
Sometimes, I mean, I have to say for a lot of like first-person shooters and like really heavy kind of action games, it often seems pretty fucking arbitrary. It's just like heavy music to kind of roughly set the mood, you know?
Right. But it does set the mood.
It does set the mood. But if the whole goal is basically to make you like pumped, then I'll listen to other stuff instead. But if you play any of their games that try to use music for ambiance of some sort, then it's actually telling you something about the game while you play. So,
well,
you
know, actually, on that note, like I have to play, I played Amnesia a little bit.
Yeah.
Which is that terrifying game. I actually had, if I played other music, it made it way less scary and it was much easier.
Of course it did.
So you play, like, put on some like Celine Dion or some shit in the background and then go deal with, you know, monsters.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, the music should go, it should enhance the game. I mean, it's part of the game design, you know, it's supposed to give the player the sense that the game designer wants the player to have while they're playing the game.
Although, when I play Rocket League, I have to listen to Turn Down for What.
Yeah, but Rocket League, it's just an action game. Like, you don't
there's no music during the gameplay.
Yeah,
so.
And it wouldn't make any sense anyway, unless it was super clever music, I guess, of some sort.
Yes.
So I would say, overall, if you're listening to other music while you're playing a game, either you're doing yourself a disservice, or you're playing a game that doesn't have music appropriate for that game.
In which case, it's totally fine.
In which case, yeah. Do whatever you want.
All right, I think we got probably time for two more questions.
Let's do it.
Let's do it. All right, next question comes from Gafferman. How is the game dev scene in St. Louis?
Ooh, well, we got something coming up here actually this weekend.
We got the Global Game Jam coming up.
Yeah, the Global Game Jam in St. Louis. It's at UMSL, and it's Friday through Sunday. It's a 48-hour game-building event, and the St. Louis scene actually has one of the biggest Global Game Jam sites in the country, if not the world, which is...
Yeah.
Crazy and cool.
Well, technically, every Global Game Jam site is one of the biggest in the world.
True.
Well, yeah.
But anyway.
Even the smallest one. I guess to me, the summary of the scene is that it's extremely active, but has no has little longevity for the average person in it.
Right.
Meaning, even though the game jams are some of the biggest game jams, they're almost entirely new people every time.
Mm-hmm.
So
one of the big challenges is essentially like you want to the general pipeline for getting someone into a community like this is you want to expose yourself to them, you know.
That's how you start most
relationships. Yeah, so you and the game jams work as a really, really powerful onboarding tool, or they can, where it's a sort of big ruckus thing. It's kind of like a little party.
You get to show yourself that you can make a game.
Right. So the game jams are sort of like the bedrock of the St. Louis game dev scene. And then from that, you'll get a very small portion of the people who actually go to the game jams. new people who are then like, oh, I can make games. I would like to do this. And now we have a bunch of resources for them to do that. So there's the, usually every month there's a meetup that has some sort of technical talk. There was actually one yesterday about how to ship games from the guy who made Cards and Castles. And I think quite a few people attended that. So there's usually like a monthly or bi-monthly sort of educational talk about some particular aspect. People do postmortems, that sort of thing. And then during the holiday party, which just happened at Christmas, everybody who made a game for the year gets a sweet, like, Boy Scouts badge sort of thing, which is cool.
Yeah.
So it's still on the rise, I would say. Like, we don't have a huge contingent of people who are fully independently making games. We have a lot of people who are doing it on the side still.
There are a lot of people who are and have been making games for a while, but the number of people who are managing to turn that into a career path is quite small.
Yeah,
but that's true. That's true for this kind of a hobby. It's a very, very, very hard to do.
Yeah,
so it's kind of inevitable.
Yeah, I think in the future for the St. Louis community, the biggest challenge is not necessarily like we know how to get people in now. We know how to handle the sort of the growth of the sort of amateur. I think it's really closing the gap between or creating some sort of pipeline between being an amateur who's interested and then being able to like fully go independent, which is just, that is a huge problem. It's just a hard thing to do. I mean, it's a hard thing to do regardless. So,
well, it's also hard in St. Louis in particular, because, you know, a lot of times the path would be, I'm interested in games. I go to some game jams. I learn a bunch of skills. After a few years, I know enough and I can get hired by a game studio. Like, that's a secure, safe route. And that route doesn't really exist in St. Louis. There's only a handful of studios, none of which anybody would consider like big.
Well, and they're not hiring a lot of people either. So
they're not hiring a lot. I mean, it's not like, what is it, like Ubisoft Montreal or something that has 1,200 employees or whatever. Right. You know, we don't have anything like that here. So even the biggest studios are about 25, 30 people at most. Yeah.
So it's got a very bootstrapping mentality, I think, because everyone's like, okay, well, if we're going to do it here, we have to just do it.
You got to just do it on your own. You got to, and it's very risky. You know, you'll need to, you know, quit your day job and live on savings and take a bunch of gambles. And, you know, for most people that prospect is rightfully very daunting and just not really an acceptable route.
Or completely impossible because racking up enough savings, where you're not being paid well in the first place and have lots of debt, et cetera, to then be able to do that is not a common kind of situation to be in.
Yeah, it's something that's definitely, it's tougher. I would say it's probably tougher in St. Louis, actually, to become a professional game developer.
Because you have to do it yourself.
Yeah, you got to do it yourself.
Absolutely.
But if you are, it is a good place, though, in terms of just kind of general camaraderie, right? Of kind of everyone being in the same difficult boat.
It has excellent indie spirit. Like everybody's just like in the trenches in St. Louis, and it's freaking awesome. Like the atmosphere is really fantastic in all these different events and stuff. And people are very passionate. Because there's so many independent developers, you don't end up with, like, we talked to a guy at GDC who was working at a large company who shall not be named. And he was telling us stories about, for example, there's a guy he knows at this company who his job is to take the different poses that characters make and create 2D shadows of those poses. And he would do this 32,000 times per game. Right. Like, that's his thing. That's what he does.
Job.
I mean, yeah, technically he's a professional game developer, you know, but he's probably not that pumped about it.
This is the guy who's nailing some boards, you know?
And so in St. Louis, nobody is nailing boards. Everybody's building a house.
Right.
Which is awesome. Okay, so last question is from Specchio. For each brother, what do you think you'll do after Butterscotch Shenanigans? Like when you retire or if you couldn't do Butterscotch Shenanigans anymore?
Ooh. We've actually gotten a very similar question to this fairly recently, if I recall.
I'll tell you. If I had to not do Butterscotch Shenanigans anymore, I would probably do Stas Studios.
just continue making games.
I don't know what circumstances would arise that would keep us from doing Butterscotch Shenanigans stuff, but I just want to make games. So I would just keep doing that. And if I couldn't do it under Butterscotch, then I would just do it some other way.
Yeah, I think the current understanding of Butterscotch is, from a public standpoint is as a game studio. And I think we do have some dreams and some ambitions for the future, being more a game studio, but a bit more more of an entertainment company in a sense, producing a lot of different stuff. So I think as far as doing it after the current iteration of Butterscotch Shenanigans, that's what I think, that's what I would like to do, is actually just build this more of like an entertainment empire sort of a thing, as opposed to just the Vidge James.
Yeah, but we still want to keep it small.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to be hard, but we'll try to do it. Okay, guys, I think that's all the time we have for this week. So thanks everybody for listening. And again, if you want to get your questions on future podcasts, just head over to podcast.bscotch.net and ask away. And you can also vote for other people's questions. And otherwise, we now have a subreddit over at reddit.com/r/crashlands. So you can join the Crashlands community there. We also have forums at forums.bscotch.net, which are currently on lockdown because we're getting...
Because you maniacs wouldn't stop repeating the same questions over and over again.
Maniacs.
You goofs.
Use the search feature.
Jeez.
But that will be turned back on
eventually.
Toward a little in a while. Yeah. At some point. And otherwise, we will see you all next week. And thanks for listening.
Goodbye.